بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، وبه نستعين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين سيدنا وحبيبنا ونبينا محمد. طيب، we completed the four major mammographic abnormality or the analysis, the systemic analysis of the four major mammographic abnormality, which are the masses, asymmetries, calcifications, and architectural distortion. And today we are going to do the special cases. So here, tell me, what are the special cases?
أنا طبعاً افتكرت هنا special cases يعني about يعني about the four major breast abnormalities اللي احنا خدناها كان في خدناها في الليكشرز الماضية يعني. أنا افتكرت special cases about abnormalities يعني ال breast abnormalities اللي كان خدناها في
يعني special pathologies.
Yes.
Okay. لا, I'm talking about the special cases on the mammographic lexicons. عبير الهادي, do you know what are the special cases? Okay, hint. What are the special cases?
These are cases.
Maybe they are the cases with the unique diagnosis on the. Sorry.
Abir is talking for whom? Huh?
Yes. I think there is another one is talking also. I am talking, yeah.
Maybe you I are Abir? Because connection. I was maybe problem in connections. I was waiting for you. When you did not answer, I asked somebody else, but you can continue.
Sorry.
No problem. No problem, continue.
Special cases, maybe they are cases that have a unique diagnosis. Unique diagnosis, I mean.
Uh-huh. Yes, uh-huh. Like? It is already presented in this image, in this page. It's already there. There is an example of the special cases presented here in the first page, in this page. You can see it now.
They are the intramammary lymph node.
Huh?
Intramammary lymph node.
Sarah Mac?
Yes.
You are welcome. Huh? Intramammary lymph node. Huh?
And single dilated duct.
Uh-huh.
صراحة نسيت يعني تقريبا من
you can see it, you will understand if you look for the mammography presented here, you'll understand which is the third one.
Third one.
You describe what? You describe the intramammary lymph node and? You mentioned for me intramammary lymph node and?
Single dilated duct, ductectasia.
Single dilated duct, intramammary lymph node. Okay. So, what is the remaining? What is this?
This can calcification, like any calcification part من ال I don't know. Skin change.
Okay. Skin lesion.
Skin lesions, okay.
Yes, skin lesions. So special cases are findings with features so typical that you don't need to describe them in details. Just you will say intramammary lymph node, solitary dilated ducts, or skin lesion without further descriptions. But these include intramammary lymph node, as we said, which is rarely important. Just we describe its locations. Skin lesions also describe only by locations, and solitary dilated duct by most of the time, these lesions is not always, most of the times are just described by their locations when they are typical, okay? And we'll see about each. Mm-hmm. This is screening mammogram, 50-year-old female, demonstrate. Mm-hmm. Demonstrate what, yes, Sarah?
It is an intramammary lymph node.
Why you said intramammary lymph node?
Okay. The shape is like the lymph node.
Uh-huh.
And adjacent to vessel.
Uh-huh.
I'm searching about the fatty hilum. Yeah, this is small.
Uh-huh.
Yes.
Why it is not an auxiliary lymph node?
It is within the breast, not within the axilla. Yes.
It is in the breast and surrounding by breast tissue. Okay. So this is a magnification view demonstrating well-defined mass. I cannot guarantee that intramammary, but I will suspect that it is an intramammary lymph node by locations, by small, sharply demarcated, except for this area, relatively loose, and might suggest fatty hilum adjacent to a vessel. By this criteria, in this case, I will suggest. So next, I will look for ultrasound. By ultrasound, the appearance is typical. Yes? Ultrasound demonstrates the typical appearance. Okay? So this is typical mammographic and sonographic lymph nodes. So the first special case is intramammary lymph nodes. Okay. So intramammary lymph nodes, as we describe, to be differentiated from those in the level 1 or lower axillary region by being surrounded by a breast tissue. It might be seen high up in the tail of expanse or the axillary tail, but when it is surrounded by breast tissue, we'll say this is intramammary rather than lower axillary lymph node, and its prevalence from 0.7 up to 48% on current studies, okay? And it depends on the methods used. Is it pathological or radiological examinations? It is the most common findings on screening mammography, seen as circumscribed masses, reniform or oval, having a hilar fat. Usually it is equal to 1 centimeter or less, but it can be larger than 1 centimeter and characterized as normal when fat replacement is pronounced. When we could see, we will appreciate good amount of fat, we'll be confident to say this is normal intramammary lymph node. And as you know, that frequently seen in the upper outer or lateral upper portion of the breast, close to the axilla. Although we can see it anywhere in the breast, extreme, medial, lower, we can see, okay? Or anywhere we can see a lymph node. It's often seen adjacent to a vessel or a vein. Why? Because the lymphatic drainage usually parallel the venous drainage. Okay, what about this? How you can describe it? Mm-hmm. Again, it is a oval, okay, lobulated. It has multiple lobule, but central fatty hilum adjacent to the vessels, high up close to the axilla, okay? And the typical appearance on ultrasound here in another case of multinodular nodule with abundant fatty hilum due to intramammary lymph nodes. Okay, look for this. This is my patients. very, very, very typical intramammary lymph node seen on the CC view here in the outer breast. Look, it has a lobulation, but you can see here the central region is low density. When we do spot magnification, we could confirm the central lucent fatty hilum. Okay, and intramammary, what about this one? It's also our patients. What is your impression, Abir, in this case?
It's well defined, lobulated, with low density hilum, fatty hilum.
This is not your way, not your usual way. So start from the middle. You are describing what, Abir?
Craniocaudal view
yes.
Of the left breast.
Excellent. Well done. Now you start correctly, huh?
Showing circumscribed density in the lateral quadrant with lobulated margins and central low dense area. But I can't appreciate a blood vessel near.
Okay. So
there is associated. I think there is associated nipple retraction.
Associated what?
Associated nipple retraction, and associated global asymmetry.
Excellent. Now you start correctly, huh? There is a global asymmetry. This is suboptimal. I don't know that what happened to the image. I tried to correct it many times. It was not like this. This is our patients. Long time before, but I don't know the image. It become like that. Huh? There is, yes, I agree. There is global asymmetry where?
In the medial part or medial quadrant.
Okay, excellent.
So I need the other views.
Okay. There is no other views, but can you tell from this image? Yes, she has valvable abnormality.
So it's suspicious. It needs further workup. I can't say this is a benign intramammary lymph node only.
Why you cannot say this is a benign intramammary lymph node?
Because of the associated findings, the global asymmetry.
Okay, the associated finding proven to be invasive ductal carcinoma. Right? So it was invasive ductal carcinoma. So why you cannot say this is just intramammary lymph node? Typical intramammary lymph node. Why?
It is
at the beginning. At the beginning, you start your description as a typical intramammary lymph node. When you start descriptions, you describe it as a typical intramammary lymph node, and now you change your mind. Okay.
As its appearance, radiographic appearance in the mammogram, it looks benign. But because of the associated feature of the invasive ductal carcinoma. So okay. I need to prove that this lymph node does not contain cancer.
I cannot guarantee, I cannot say this is typical intramammary lymph node because the cortex a little bit is thickened. It has a diffuse cortical thickening in expense of fatty hilum. It is a slit-like fatty hilum. But I cannot just, I will say it is non-specific or is borderline. I need to characterize it further by ultrasound. Okay, because here, this is, if you look for the cortex, yes, it is oval, it is circumscribed, but the cortex is thickened, really thickened cortex. And it was in it was a malignant intramammary lymph nodes, okay? It was a metastatic lymph node.
Okay.
So good, your approach is correct. Since the patient, she has other findings, we should not just pass it. So the normal intramammary lymph node may enlarge in the breast as the reactions to inflammations or inflammatory conditions like skin changes or like this, but can also enlarge as a reaction to metastatic involvement. When they do so, it become more rounded. Still, it will be most of the time well-defined, homogeneous, high density mass, okay? Larger than 1 centimeter. And in this case, it is also larger than 1 centimeter. It was larger in diameter, okay? What are the alarming features? Telling you this, the intramammary lymph node is not normal lymph node. When you will say the intramammary lymph node is not a typical lymph node or is not yani, a benign lymph node or is not a normal lymph node, I mean.
In case of loss of its fatty hilum, if it is rounded more than oval. Increasing in size in different accounts.
What? You said what? If it is. Yeah. Be confident.
You are correct. In different scans.
Yeah, on follow up, increasing the size of follow up. Okay. Become rounded. Okay. Losing the fatty hilum. Okay. What else?
Focal bulge of the cortex, representing focal infiltration by the.
Okay. Yeah, diffuse or focal?
Or focal.
Cortical thickening. Diffuse or focal. So we have to be aware about the typical and atypical characteristics so as to understand when we have to do further investigation for this intramammary lymph node when necessary. Abnormal lymph nodes, we are managing the intramammary lymph node or describing the intramammary lymph node same as the intra-axillary lymph node. At the end, it is a lymph node having the same anatomical and morphological appearance. Okay? The only difference is that in the axilla, and this is within the breast. So if diminished or absent fatty hilum, that means it's not a typical normal intramammary lymph node. If it has a thickened cortex, if a non-circumscribed margin, having a non-circumscribed margin, whatever, become speculated, become indistinct, become lobulated, microlobulated, like the mass. The margins, we are describing the margins as if we're describing the margin of the mass. Increase in size on interval, okay? Or the changing characters on interval. This warrant additional follow-up or pathological analysis to exclude malignancy. Okay, so is it always atypical intramammary lymph node? It means metastatic lymph node.
Could be reactive.
I have seen metastatic, I have seen abnormal intramammary lymph node. Is it always, it means that it is a metastatic node?
It could be reactive.
It could be reactive, it's okay. It could be. It could be neoplastic metastasis from.
Sorry?
It could be metastasis from extramammary, primary, or it could be lymphoproliferative like lymphoma.
Yes.
Okay? And it could be benign with different. Is differential diagnosis include what? If it is benign, enlarged benign lymph nodes, what are the differential diagnoses for benign lymph nodes? Enlargement. Like axilla, what are the causes for the benign enlargement of the axillary lymph node? The same pathology that cause enlargement of the axillary lymph node will result in the enlargement of intramammary lymph node, which are, you mentioned the reactive, inflammatory lymph node reactive, reactive hyperplasia, what else?
Mastitis.
What?
Inflammatory causes like mastitis.
Okay. What else?
Could be tuberculosis.
Okay, excellent. We said in a patient known to have breast cancer, intramammary lymph node is a potential site for locoregional spread. And it can affect or change the prognosis and management of the patient. So, as Abir described for that lymph node, since the patient having a breast cancer, she has to consider this intramammary lymph node and to evaluate it well. Okay, to exclude metastatic disease. Also, sometimes small lesions, 1 centimeter or less or nodule in the upper outer typical location of intramammary lymph node, simulating a lymph node might turn out to be small breast carcinoma. So small breast carcinoma can also mimic an intramammary lymph node. So we have to be cautious when evaluating intramammary lymph node. Okay. And a small change in node size are of no concern if the fatty hilum is preserved, the nodes are non-bulbable, and the patient has no history of malignancy. Just on interval, if the the lymph node being just it will be reactive lymph node. It's getting larger, but the patient having no history of malignancy and the node not bulbable and the fatty hilum is well preserved, it will not be concerning. It has no clinical concern. The other causes of intramammary lymph nodes, as we described, the malignant types are lymphoproliferative, metastatic breast cancer, and extra mammary metastasis, from especially from the lung, melanoma, thyroid, and ovaries. Okay. While the benign causes, reactive hyperplasia, silicon-induced lymphadenopathy, Castleman disease, collagen vascular disease, HIV-associated lymphadenopathy, tuberculosis, toxoplasmosis, and viral infections. Okay, this ultrasound demonstrate? Mm-hmm. Demonstrate what? Can you see anything here in this ultrasound?
Yes, intramammary lymph node. Intramammary lymph node. It's an oval shaped with fatty hilum, preserved fatty hilum, but there is.
Where? Do you have seen where?
Just I'm
where
looking
have you
if
seen,
I can.
See,
I'm looking if I can just point. I don't know how can I point.
You can tell within the anterior breast, within the middle, within the posterior, within the fatty breast, part of the breast, within the glandular, like that. You can describe.
Okay. Yes. Just below the subcutaneous fat. No.
Subcutaneous fat.
Just go the other side.
Yeah.
Go to the left node, to the other side.
Uh-huh.
Just below, yes. Go down. Yes, here.
Yeah, so within this is the part, the fibroglandular. So the lymph node, it is within the fibroglandular tissue. You see, that is why it's difficult to be appreciated. Because the fatty hilum is usually iso to fibroglandular tissue. And sometimes the cortex, the hypocogenicity of the cortex, a little bit iso to the fat globule. So sometimes it's difficult to be appreciated, but that is the lymph node here is measured. You see a small intramammary lymph node within the fibroglandular. So this is the commonest location. About 70% of the intramammary lymph node is present in the upper outer quadrant, and as we mentioned, can be seen anywhere within the breast. So let us see what are the normal and abnormal features of intramammary lymph node in the breast images. Okay, what about this one? Yes, we touch the normal and abnormal, but we'd like to emphasize on this.
Okay, it is well circumscribed.
Uh-huh.
It's fatty hilum.
Uh-huh.
The location of a lymph node near vessels.
Uh-huh.
Within.
Is it typical or atypical? Normal or abnormal?
Just one thing, I'm not sure about that. This fatty hilum is
by your descriptions, you describe the typical intramammary lymph node, the normal one.
Yes.
When you describe the normal one. Why you get hesitating when I ask you, is it a typical or not typical?
I'm not sure about your description
from the beginning. You will describe either a typical one or non-typical one, or either a normal or pathological one. Since you describe it as a normal or a typical one, that is a normal or that is typical. Okay. Tell me here on ultrasound how you are going to describe this intramammary lymph node.
It's an oval shape.
Oval.
Reform with the. Preserved hilum.
Oval.
Oval, well circumscribed.
Circumscribed, uh-huh.
With preserved fatty hilum.
With preserved or abundant fatty hilum, it's okay.
Uh-huh. And normal cortical thickness.
Okay. The hilum echogenicity is equal to fibroglandular tissue. And the cortex is hypocoic and is not thickened and is uniform. And the gland, it looks like a kidney, small kidney shape. Okay. So normally in intramammary lymph nodes, circumscribed hyperechoic hilum, hypochoic cortex, and it resembles miniature kidney, okay? And the cortex less than 3 millimeter, like intramammary lymph nodes, same. It is hypo compared to the fat, but sometimes it looks like an iso or a slightly subtle hypo to the surrounding fat lobules, okay? And the fatty hilum is iso with the fibroglandular tissue, okay? And far more echogenic than the fat lobules, the fatty hilum, okay? Okay, what about on MRI? We have seen it on mammography, a circumscribed mass, okay, iso or slightly low density with central lucency due to fatty hilum and adjacent vessels small, less than 1 centimeter, and commonly in the upper outer crest. On ultrasound, circumscribed, kidney shape, or lentiform with thin cortex, slightly lower compared to the adjacent fat lobules, or hypochoic cortex is smooth, uniform, less than 3 millimeter, central hilum echogenic, equal to the fibroglandular tissue, small. You might see the vessels, adjacent vessels or vessels entering the fatty hilum on Doppler scan. What about the MRI?
Also oval shaped, circumscribed, and in T1 it shows the hilum shows the signal intensity similar to the fat. And on fat suppression, the fatty hilum is suppressed.
So the fatty hilum following the fat signal in all sequences. When the fat is preserved, the fatty hilum will be seen. When the fat is suppressed, the fatty hilum it will get suppressed. Okay, following the fat signal.
Yes.
And also smooth, circumscribed, oval, or lentiform.
And it seems to be less than 1 centimeter. Small,
commonly upper outer can be seen anywhere. It's okay. What else? What other characters?
Uniform cortical thickness.
Uniform cortical thickness. What else? More characters.
And near
MRI, you know that on MRI the characters will be more.
Was the near the vessels?
What about T2 signal? What about both contrast? Still you have
the cortex, characters. The cortex shows uniform contrast enhancement.
Yes, uniform homogeneous contrast enhancement on T2. How it appear on T2? It is high on T2, okay? And it demonstrates homogeneous enhancement can be intense enhancement. And what about the kinetics? The curves? The kinetic curves, time intensity curves of lymph node.
Lymph node. As I remember, even it can show it's not type 1 curve. It can even show type early washout.
Excellent. Lymph node can demonstrate type 3 curves, it can just the normal lymph node and demonstrate the washout curves. So we have to be cautious when evaluating the lymph nodes, not depending only on the kinetics. We need to correlate the kinetics with the morphological criteria, because the kinetics can be suspicious, can give us the intense peak of uptake of contrast with rapid washout, type 3, suspicious or malignant type of curves. Okay? Circumscribed, reniform mass with higher fat in T1 weighted non-fat sat, and the cortex demonstrate homogeneous enhancement and high signal intensity at T2 in case of intramammary lymph nodes. Okay, these here on mammography, same lymph node. This is a lymph node on mammography, on ultrasound, and on the MRI. In all, we could appreciate the same morphological criteria, with exception that on MRI give more characters due to inherent tissue contrast, characteristic of the MRI. So the normal lymph nodes are typically described in all images, okay, or all breast imaging, as the circumscribed mass is smaller than 10 millimeter, oval or reniform in shape, with the hilar fat, usually peripheral locations adjacent to a vein, stable over time in comparative studies, okay? Beside the morphological features, as we describe, intramammary lymph node may show hilar visualizations, vascularization on Doppler, as we described before, and at MRI, high on T2 characters, okay? And homogeneous enhancement may show suspicious findings on kinetic curve, as we described, such as washout in delayed phase, and breast masses lacking these features cannot report it as normal intramammary lymph node. If all these criteria could not be applied to the intramammary small nodule, we cannot say just this is intramammary lymph node. So we have features, okay, typical features of normal and abnormal lymph node, or typical or non-typical lymph node regarding the shape. What about the shape? Huh? Over reniform, rounded or lobulated. Margins?
Well, circumscribed.
Circumscribed, non-circumscribed. Size?
Less than 1 centimeter.
1 centimeter or less. Okay, calcifications?
No calcifications.
No calcification, absent. Hilar fat? Should be
preserved
or present, or maybe pronounced in normal. If it is eccentric or absent or attenuated, it will be abnormal. Mm-hmm. And then usually adjacent to the vein or vessels, and significant alteration in size in morphology on follow-up, this is the abnormal one. Okay. So, abnormal benign intramammary lymph nodes. These patients with previous right breast cancer. This is her MRI. Demonstrate what? Can you describe this lesion? And this is the ultrasound of the same lesions. Huh? Let us go quickly.
Oval, well, circumscribed. High intensity in the outer.
High intensity? What is the sequence of the contrast of the MRI?
Here there is a fat sat. So with contrast enhancement.
Yeah, contrast enhanced sequence. So, fat sat contrast enhanced sequence. So
homogeneous contrast enhancement.
Are you sure? Is it homogeneous?
It's all of it is enhancing, but some areas are more than the others.
So some areas more than the others, that means inhomogeneous. At least if I will not say heterogeneous, I would say inhomogeneous enhancement.
Okay.
Okay. So okay. When cortical area enhance more than the rest.
In the outer.
Yes, it is oval. With I cannot see the fatty hilum, and the enhancement is not homogeneous fat. This is what can I see? That is it. No more any available characters, so I can describe it. So yes. What about ultrasound? This is ultrasound of the same lesions.
In ultrasound, it's more rounded. The margin is it is lobulate. The fatty hilum is eccentric.
Aywa, that is it. Yeah, it is oval. Yes, it is not any so elongated or so uniform, but at least still elongated. Okay, it's still oval. I mean, it's still oval. Okay, and it's still circumscribed. The only features is asymmetric cortical thickening with eccentric attenuated fatty hilum.
Yes.
See? This is corresponding to that seen on O-type. In this case, how you are going to manage these patients? You are considering as normal inflammatory lymph node?
No.
Why?
The eccentric fatty hilum and area of cortical thickening. So.
Okay, and the patient supported by the patient having
previous
history of breast
cancer. Yeah.
You see, I have to consider even minimal or low suspicious features. I will consider if the patient having history of breast cancer. So in this case, I have to go to do biopsy.
Yeah.
And it turned out to be just reactive lymph nodes. You see? The patient, yes, having previous breast cancer, right breast cancer, submitted to nipple sparing mastectomy, presented with atypical intramammary lymph node in the upper outer quadrant of the same breast at ultrasound and MRI, as you describe it, yes, they describe it as round, excellent. I have seen it still oval toward the rounding, but still not very rounded. Okay, but they describe it as rounded, eccentric hilum, thickened heterogeneous cortex on ultrasound, okay? And percutaneous guided ultrasound biopsy, negative for malignancy and confirmed to be reactive inflammatory intramammary lymph nodes, okay?
Okay.
So some benign inflammatory conditions may be associated with imaging detected suspected abnormal intramammary lymph node. One causes of the positive intramammary lymph node is reactive hyperplasia, which is just the normal lymph node response to any antigenic stimulus, such as localized or systemic inflammations, or for example, the patient submitted to breast cancer therapy including mastectomy or breast conservative surgery and radiation therapy. Also, they might develop reactive adenopathy. May presenting as atypical reactive lymph node with enlargement and cortical thickening. But by imaging, we cannot decide if it is reactive or neoplastic. We have to further evaluation by biopsy and correlate with pathology. Okay, what about this case, Abir al-Hadi? Tell me. What about this case? Intramammary lymph node. What do you think about this intramammary? You have many mammography here.
Yes. Okay. First of all, I want to know the sequence of this mammogram from
excellent. Well done. Excellent. Okay. I was waiting for these questions. Now you can know the sequences, yeah? By the end.
Okay, so the earlier one is A. It showed a little bit dense. Not dense. It is maybe isodense to the breast. Intramammary lymph node. Then the follow-up mammogram B showed that the lymph node become larger in size, more dense, but it preserved. Lobulated and with preservation of its slit-like fatty hilum.
If this patient having contralateral mastectomy?
Okay. Also, I think there is associated architectural distortion. More prominent in mammogram B. Okay.
So how you are going to manage this note?
I will. First of all, I will do a spot magnification view and ultrasound for more characterization of this lymph node.
That is ultrasound.
Putting in mind, yes, in ultrasound, it appears
D is the first ultrasound and E is the second ultrasound. E is ultrasound following, supplementing mammography C, and D is ultrasound adjuncted mammography B, or supplemented the mammography B.
Okay, the lymph node on D has irregular shape. With the thickened cortex. And inhomogeneous fatty hilum, and it's eccentric. So putting in mind the history of the patient, I will put this suspicious lymph node for biopsy.
Okay, being enlarged on interval without any changing characters in a patient having breast cancer is an indication for biopsy. But what happened? What about B and C?
It is mammography, it gets less in size, it decreases in size and density also.
And following the same on ultrasound.
Yeah.
So what do you suspect?
Can I say this is a regression in the disease process?
Yeah, regression, yes.
Despite the increase in size in the in B, mammogram B.
Yeah, this is on interval. I'll let you know the story. The patient with typical intramammary lymph node in upper outer quadrant, okay, had screening mammography. After 1 year, the new screening exam showed increase in intramammary lymph node and biopsy suggested. However, after 2 months, okay, when the patient returned to perform the biopsy, the intramammary lymph node showed spontaneous regression to normal size because it was a reactive lymph node. Okay, so the biopsy procedure was suspended. Okay,
thank you.
So it was just a reactive inflammatory intramammary lymph node. However, sometimes it's difficult to exclude the possibility of recurrence adding this patient based or other patients solely on imaging findings. Sometimes reactive intramammary lymph node may show spontaneous regression on follow-up studies which confirm its benign etiology. Okay, Suher.
Okay, this is mediolateral. A is mediolateral oblique view of the right breast, and B, the middle one, craniocaudal view of the same breast. And B is an ultrasound showing well-defined circumscribed oval shape mass at the lateral part of the breast with central high density region.
High density region, or the whole mass is high density?
The whole mass show high density region. On ultrasound, showing snowstorm appearance. So this may represent granulomatous inflammation of the lymph node.
Your description signify what you said. It demonstrate.
Circumscribe oval shape, high density.
Yeah, on mammography, you describe on ultrasound as
well-defined. For me, it is a snowstorm appearance.
Excellent. It demonstrates snowstorm appearance. Signify what does it indicate? This snowstorm appearance.
It indicates silicon rupture at the breast.
Yes. Yes, excellent. Indicating extracapsular rupture and silicon migration to the lymph node. Okay. This is silicon adenopathy.
Yes.
It is dense on mammography and snowstorm appearance on ultrasound. Yes. This intramammary lymph node with silicon induced adenopathy. Okay. Due to extracapsular rupture. Excellent, well done. Snowstorm appearance, typical. Okay, so another cause of benign atypical intramammary lymph node is silicon-induced lymphadenopathy related to implant rupture and silicon leakage, which can also mimic malignancy, especially at mammography. Without ultrasound, you have a dense lymph node. You don't know why this lymph node is dense. but ultrasound is more characteristic, giving the snowstorm appearance. And even, you see, more sensitive, this snowstorm appearance is more sensitive ultrasound criteria than the silicon signal at MRI. You got the point. And ultrasound is more helpful in this manner to differentiate the silicon adenopathy from malignant silicon than MRI or mammography. Okay. Huh, Sarah Elmack?
Okay. This is a mammogram of an MRI study of the right breast, CC view, and MRI T1 with FATSA T1 with contrast. There is an enlarged, there is an enlarged L-defined hyperdense mass located within the medial side of the right breast or the inner part of the inner mid breast. Okay. This mass, there is adjacent architectural distortion noted. And this mass showed intense homogeneous enhancement at MRI. There is at the lateral aspect of the right breast, mid breast, there is a well-defined oval shape, high lesion with fatty hilum adjacent to vessel, likely representing an intermammary lymph node.
Okay,
and also in MRI, it showed the intense enhancement. Although it looks like an for me, it looks normal. In the MRI, I couldn't. I don't know about the MRI.
Okay, on mammography.
It looks like a normal intramammary lymph node, but with the presence of this mass, I will recommend a biopsy of this or further evaluation of this intramammary lymph node.
Okay, we'll see ultrasound, I'll see the other sequences of MRI because it looks thickened cortex, expense of fatty hilum. You see the only things is the cortex, it is small, but the cortex looks a little bit thickened. Okay. Mammography showing invasive breast carcinoma in the inner quadrant of the right breast associated with an atypical intramammary lymph node in the outer and proven to be metastatic. Confirmed as metastatic adenopathy. Okay. This, I will not pass it. The cortex is not the typical lymph nodes. It is bulky like lymph nodes. So metastatic, it is a metastatic lymph node.
From the mammogram?
Huh? What? Okay, so intramammary lymph nodes are, as we mentioned, potential site of locoregional spread of our ipsilateral breast cancer, and the incidence range between 1 and 34%, and are found in the same quadrant as the primary tumor in almost 50%. Metastatic adenopathy on the same quadrant seen in up to 50%, which can change the prognosis and management. The evaluation of intramammary lymph node should be be meticulous in patients with pre-suspicion imaging features or suspicious imaging features should be considered on those type of group of patients. Okay, if there is the eccentric hilum, focal cortical thickening, diffuse cortical thickening, borderline, and equal to or just greater than 3 millimeter, add in these lymph nodes. These lymph nodes, if it is seen in a normal patient, you might pass it. But if it's seen in a patient having ipsilateral, same quadrant, breast cancer, you will not pass it. You have to consider the cortex if it is even just 3 millimeter. The hilum is not abundant hilum. If the hilum, the vessels are relatively big vessels coming to it. So any minor features, you have to consider it if the patient is breast cancer to exclude locoregional metastatic disease. In contrast, okay, this is an example here. This is intramammary lymph node. This lesion was described as intramammary lymph node, has a fatty hilum. The evaluation, as we mentioned, it should be meticulous. The position is typical of an intramammary lymph node, and there is central lucency, signifies the fatty hilum. Usually, and should be stable on follow-up, but okay, they are mostly seen in the upper outer quadrant breast and atypical, well-defined, it's mostly circumscribed lesion, low density within the hilum, okay, small, and the lesions, okay, if on the follow-up, this lesion demonstrates subtle, okay, enlargement, then you have, or any changing characters, you have to consider it in the patient having history of ipsilateral or even contralateral breast cancer. So in spite of being typical, but if I have seen it slightly larger on interval, then I will consider it in the patient with breast cancer. However, in contrast, the patient having no breast cancer, only high suspicious features of lymph node, I will take it to raise the possibility of neoplastic process. Okay? For breast cancer patient, intramammary lymph node, minor or very, very low suspicious feature, I will consider it. But in contrast, the patient have no history of breast cancer, normal patients, unless I have high suspicious features, the intramammary lymph node, I will not raise the element of suspicion. I will not recommend biopsy unless I have high suspicious features. Why? And what are these features? What are the features I have to consider it to recommend biopsy? And why I'm not recommend biopsy unless high suspicious features available?
Because usually the lymph node, yani, reactive lymph node is very common.
Okay.
And yes, and benign causes of enlarged lymph node are very common.
Yeah, okay.
So it will lead to unnecessarily.
And what are these features? What are the features I have to consider it? Yes, to avoid unnecessarily biopsy, okay? Because,
we have to consider the shape.
Okay.
It will be rounded in shape, okay? Okay. We have to consider focal cortical thickening. And we have the criteria more than 3 centimeter.
Okay. Yes, here, and if the patient is breast cancer, only 3 centimeter or slightly above, I will consider. But if the patient know from 5 centimeter or more, least it will be high suspicious. Then okay. I will consider it. Because yani, from 3 to 5, it might be still reactive lymph node.
Yes, okay? Yes, yes. And also the increased vascularity, especially with the if there is vascularity within the cortex.
Okay. Yes. Mm. Uh-huh. Cortical vascularity. Uh-huh.
Yes. And
okay.
Uh-huh. I think this is the most important.
Okay. So if eccentric or focal or diffuse cortical thickening equal 2 or greater than 5 millimeters, okay, or complete loss of fatty hilum, or the cortex become deeply hypoechoic or cystic, necrotic cortex, or the vascularity, cortical vascularity as we describe. Okay, why? Because the prevalence of malignancy in these populations is low. Drama Mary lymph node in this group, it will be low. So I'm not going to recommend biopsy unless they have high suspicious features. Okay, metastatic intramammary lymph node and also mimic asynchronous benign mass in a patient with breast cancer. How we can differentiate? As the first case we have seen, there was no fatty hilum. On mammography, the fatty hilum was not very clear unless we do ultrasound. You see, it was not very typical. It was only just isodanes nodule. So mimicking benign mass. When I have seen it like that, how can I differentiate this nodule? It could be a benign nodule or a lymph node. If there is no fatty hilum, just to emphasize on the same point, look at the, if there is any adjacent vascularity. At that, usually there is vessel adjacent to the intramammary lymph node. Okay, who's going to take this case? So far, so good. Huh? Hint, would you like to take this case?
Okay, MRI breast, fat sat with contrast, showing in the right breast a mass which is irregular with heterogeneous enhancement, as the center of the mass is not enhanced. And
it was invasive cancer, okay?
Okay, and there is in the posterior aspect of the breast, encircled with the yellow circle, there is a small, another mass lesion, or it could be lymph node. It is oval, small oval and enhancing. Mm-hmm. So it could be a metastatic lymph node from the mass, from the cancer.
Okay, or can be another nodule.
Or another mass.
Another cancer. It can be another cancer. It can be, I need to clarify to see the other images or to look at.
Okay, I can do
at least the first lesion has pathological diagnosis. So what is next for that, the other nodule? I don't know what is exactly the nature. It can be another asynchronous cancer, or it can be يعني multi centric I mean malignancy or intramammary lymph nodes. So what is ultrasound. Next?
To augment it by an ultrasound.
Ultrasound, we call it as
complementary.
After MRI, we are doing target ultrasound, we call it second look ultrasound. So, okay. So this is a second look ultrasound.
Second look, okay. So it shows, yes, it looks like an oval, but the margins are ill or irregular.
Mm-hmm. Indistinct margins, okay. Heterogeneous, it looks margin. A little bit heterogeneous with indistinct margins. So I need to biopsy, okay? So.
Yes, and the fatty hilum is small. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, attenuated. The fatty hilum is attenuated, it's okay? It is atypical. It is atypical intramammary lymph node and biopsy proven to be metastatic. They confirmed after biopsy to be metastatic lymph nodes. Okay. As you described before, more toward rounded, and the fatty hilum is gone, slit like only. It's okay and indistinct, and it was metastatic. Okay. Huh. Abir, again. طيب أنا ما أعرف الموجود منه عشان الدور. Okay. دور عليك انت ولا سهير؟ مفتقدين مدينة اليوم، اوكي؟ ها؟ وفاء is also not available. عليكم السلام.
Yeah, sorry, I have really today a problem with my connection. Okay.
Abir?
These are craniocaudal, yes. These are craniocaudal mammograms of the left breast. Please, would you tell me the sequence of them regarding the Yes, okay. So the earlier one showed tiny intramammary dense lesion. I can't appreciate the fatty hilum in it. It's so small. But there is a blood vessel near it.
Mm-hmm. Excellent. There is tiny central lucens. It's okay. So suspected. Suspected to be.
It's suspected to be an intramammary lymph node.
Excellent. Suspected to what happened to it? Erred by? Which arrow?
It's increasing in size. It's a green arrow.
The green arrow,
Yes. Mm-hmm. It's increasing in size in the following mammograms. It's increasing in size and density. There is an associated
it doesn't look significantly increased, more or less stable. Maybe, I don't know, but to me, I've seen it from near here, it looks like unstable. Okay.
But it appears that in the following mammograms, there is another associated feature in form of focal density.
We call it what? By now, we have to describe following the BI-RADS, yeah? Lexicon.
It's a speculated mass.
In the Ferris one, I will describe it as on the middle mammogram, I will describe it as
round
something obesity not seen in the previous or increasing in size. We call it
developing density.
Density or
obesity, developing obesity.
Developing
asymmetry.
Developing
focal obesity.
Developing asymmetry. Developing asymmetry.
Okay. Developing asymmetry.
Yeah, you forget the earliest lectures. We call it developing asymmetry. Okay, and yes, so you are going to describe the Ferris one, the green arrow pointed to small opacity, more or less stable on 3 mammogram, more or less. Doesn't show remarkable change in size or characters. While just posterior to which there is in the middle mammogram, small developing asymmetry that's shown to be as an irregular dense speculated mass on the latest mammography. Yes?
Yes.
Yes.
So it will be BI-RADS 5, which is
BI-RADS 5 because of the speculated mass. However, the lymph node doesn't. At this moment, I cannot say this metastatic lymph node. I don't know how they. Okay. Circumscribed mass simulating another. Yes, this is the brought it here because in the middle mammography, they thought this is another intramammary lymph node. See, because of this lymph node, the anterior one, when the patient having an oval lesions, small, they thought these lesions, it might represent another intramammary lymph node. But that is why they did not recommend biopsy or go further till the 6 months mammography, okay? Or they report it as probably intramammary lymph node for 6 months follow-up and the lesion progressing because it was a malignant, okay? And confirmed to be an invasive cancer. So they brought this as a mimicker for intramammary lymph node. Cancer can mimic, or early cancer can mimic intramammary lymph node. That is why we have to be cautious. So in rare cases, a small breast carcinoma can mimic intramammary lymph node at mammography. How to manage these type of cases? So we have to be aware how to manage the patients. If we have seen a small nodule, it might be intramammary lymph node as in this case. So how you are going to manage the case? If this is coming to you, Yabir, in your clinic, you are reporting mammography and the coming to you this intramammary lymph node with another suspecting intramammary lymph node posterior adjacent which. How you are going to manage?
Okay. First of all, I will put in my mind the history of the patient. If he has any alarming thing in his history, in heart history, sorry, like previous history of breast cancer or other cancers.
If she has
strong family history.
If she has no,
Okay. I will search for other associated features in the imaging, other suspicious feature or alarming features.
Okay. As you have seen in that mammo, there was nothing. Only the nodule on interval, appear on interval. Okay. And at the beginning, it was circumscribed. So it can be intramammary lymph node.
Yes. I will do other images like ultrasound.
Before doing other images,
spot magnification.
You compare it with the previous to see if that module it was there or new one. Yes, in this case, they compare and found to be a new. Okay, then you can do spot if you suspect that. The lesion can the surrounding breast is there is parenchyma or just to spray it away and to see the margin of the region if distinct or indistinct or something. Okay, and you can just follow and target it by ultrasound. Okay. If still not clear, then you can follow up the patient.
I will put the patient on short-term follow-up.
Short-term follow-up. So it depends. If there is the nodule associated with suspicious findings, as you mentioned, then you will go for biopsy. If no, you will go for short-term follow-up. You will put a 3. Okay? So comparison to the previous exam to identify these type of cases. It helped to identify complementary ultrasound or short-term follow-up, as we described. Any new or enlarging masses should be carefully assessed for minimally suspicious signs, such as slight blurring of margins, or to avoid missing early cancer. Okay? We have to. Okay. Another patients would like to take this case. Follow-up mammography of patient with previous breast cancer submitted to conservative surgery. This is her follow-up. Where? Where are you?
This is mediolateral oblique view of the left breast showing.
Your voice. Of... You are far from.
This is mediolateral. This is mediolateral oblique view of the left breast showing and multiple suture and stitches denoting the surgery of the conservative surgery in at the history and at the upper part of the breast posteriorly there was two ill-defined or the largest well circumscribed high density mass as and associated another one the small show in this neck margin and high density mass. These two lesions or two high density lesions, recurrence or residual of the or metastasis from the previous cancer of the breast. So I would like to see the previous.
So the locations, the location is typical for intramammary lymph
node surrounded by the vessels. Yes.
Yes, so it can be intramammary lymph node, but I cannot consider it as typical. These yes. are atypical. If or it can be
masses,
it can
or
be just
masses or lymph node.
Yeah, it can be new masses or lymph node. So it can be recurrence or it can be metastasis to intramammary lymph node, or it can be reactive lymph node.
Yes, so I would like to see the previous. I would like to see the previous images.
The previous, okay. If not available.
You'd like to do a ultrasound for more characterization of this lesion.
Okay, this is the other view. Okay. It looks.
The largest one show abnormal focal abnormal focal thickening with centered center lucency. I think this representing intramammary lymph node. And the smallest one, I couldn't appreciate this.
I will say atypical. There is a lesions. You see a dense indistinct lesions. It can be atypical intramammary lymph node, but it's not the typical or normal intramammary. It can be metastatic, reactive, or lymph nodes, intramammary lymph nodes versus recurrence. So yes. I will go for ultrasound.
Ultrasound, yes.
This is the ultrasound.
Ultrasound for the newest or the previous? This ultrasound.
No, this is the same patients. This is I don't know.
Yes.
Uh-huh.
Yes, for this after surgery. This ultrasound.
Both these are both after surgery.
No, the lymph ultrasound. Ultrasound
following the. I don't know that the second mammography maybe is a short term follow up. If it is short term, it looks like a short term follow up. I don't remember exactly, but if it's short-term follow-up, it demonstrates that there is an interval increase in size because it seemed to be both MLO.
Okay.
Interval increase and ultrasound.
Ultrasound show indistinct margin of.
Yes, it shows a suspicious, small suspicious mass with no circumscribed. And faint posterior. Shadowing.
Yes, with absent hilum and posterior acoustic shadowing.
I am not so hilum. Here I will just describe it as a mass. It looks like an mass. It's not, it doesn't look like an
lymph node. Yes,
yeah. If I suspect this to be follow-up, it seems to be increasing in size on interval. Yes. If it is this short term, it seemed to be. I thought at the beginning just this might be different angle, but since both MLO, most likely this will be follow-up. So if it's follow-up, definitely it looks like larger in size and the ultrasound is suspicious. So in this case, it's either
to do a biopsy. Metastatic
lymph nodes or recurrence.
So you have to do a biopsy.
Follow-up mammography presenting is small circumscribed mass in the left upper outer mimicking intramammary lymph node. Prior exam were not available. Yes, this 6 months follow-up demonstrate increase in size. Okay, the other mammography is 6 months, which corresponding to irregular hypopoic mass on ultrasound and biopsy revealed recurrent invasive carcinoma after biopsy. Okay. So this is another case. Hint.
Yes, 55 years old, asymptomatic woman presented for annual screening mammography. She had been undergoing therapy with conjugated estrogens ever since, undergoing a hysterectomy at age 36. Her mother was diagnosed with breast cancer at age 65. Mammography, computed tomography, and scintigraphy were performed. Yes.
So, considered as
a high risk patient.
The risk patient, yes. The above average risk or high risk patients. Okay. is on estrogen and her mother having, though her age of cancer of her mother a little bit looks postmenopausal.
Yes,
postmenopausal, but still giving her risk of breast cancer. It's okay. Huh?
So the CCVOA and MLO B and compression magnification view showed in the upper posterior part of the breast an oval shape circumscribed equal density mass or region near the blood vessel with other smaller regions in the posterior and middle aspect of the breast. The compression magnification view showed it to be of also oval circumscribed. I cannot appreciate a fatty hilum, but just the position is near the blood vessel. So we need other imaging modality, ultrasound. I will look for other lesions or within the breast.
What do you suspect for that lesion?
It could be, there could be a lesion with the breast, and this is for example, I am suspecting malignancy with metastasis to lymph nodes.
So, lymph node where? You look at the spot magnification, it is near to the pectoralis, but it is not within the axilla. So it is close to the axilla, but not in the axilla. So these are most likely
intramammary lesions.
Intramammary lymph nodes.
Yes.
Close to the vessels and cold. These are, but is it typical intramammary lymph nodes?
I cannot appreciate any fatty hilum.
So these are atypical intramammary lymph nodes. These are pathological intramammary lymph nodes. But I don't know exactly, you see, what is it malignant or non-malignant, but are pathological, are atypical in intramammary lymph nodes. Okay, so I'm going to look for any suspicious features within the breast. Can you see anything within the breast?
I think there is global asymmetry.
I don't know, I'm not sure, but I can see subtle changes. I'm not sure if it is correct or not. If you look to the lateral CC view, as if there is subtle architectural distortion, but I don't know the significance of this. Okay, let us see what they put in the descriptions. Cranicaudal mediolateral mammogram demonstrate abnormally enlarged and dense node in the left auxiliary tail, okay? Additional mediolateral not shown was obtained to evaluate the region of pectoralis muscles. And the node had more than double in size since previous mammography, okay? So the patient having previous mammography, you have to ask about the previous mammography before going for ultrasound. And they said before that they double in size. So signify this is most likely it will be neoplastic process.
Yes.
Okay. And the spot magnification MLO better depict the abnormal density of the lymph node without clearly defined radiolucent hilum. And they mentioned that there is subtle asymmetry and distortion of the left breast, apparent only in the craniocaudal was identified retrospectively. They did not mention exactly where, but probably the same area I'm talking about. You see this area?
Yes.
Huh? There is, this is outer aspect is distorted. If you compare it with a, if you just put a line in the middle and look for the outer and the inner, you will look extreme outer showing some distortion. Okay, you'll go for ultrasound, but they have done this CT for the patient. Huh? Okay. What does it show?
It shows asymmetry within the left breast.
Mm-hmm.
And it shows also other lymph nodes, the one in the posterior aspect of the breast, as well as two other lymph nodes within the axilla.
Yes, it demonstrates asymmetric lymph node compared to the contralateral within the axilla as well as in the axillary tail.
And these lymph nodes around it.
And even the vessels here, it looks the vascularity, but also there is some asymmetry in the vascularity between the two breasts. Although this is only single view, but findings are suspicious. Okay? So CT demonstrate enlarged intramammary and axillary lymph nodes, asymmetric density in the left breast. So what is this study?
Scintigraphy mammography.
Scintimammography, excellent. Scintimammography. Scintimammography. Uh-huh. Demonstrate what?
The left lateral and right lateral shows the two lymph nodes within the axilla.
What is the difference between the two views, A and B?
This is lateral view A, and B is anterior posterior or anterior.
Uh-huh.
So in the A, the right breast shows an area taken or hot area at the breast, as well as the axilla, two lymph nodes within the axilla.
Yes, excellent. Uh-huh.
In the anterior view also, a large area was in the left breast, and just below it, this black arrow points to a lymph node also.
Oh, you said the lymph node. Is another focus of uptake. You don't know this focus of uptake. Yes, those in the axilla, you can see. The axilla, yes. These are lymph nodes. But within the breast, you don't know what is that uptake. It can be lymph node or it can be another focus. So there is a large area, almost in the medial outer aspect of the breast. So the malignancy is large. So, scintigraphy demonstrates large multiloculated area of uptake, both the medial and lateral left upper breast, an additional focus of uptake is identified in the lower inner breast. It is the focus of uptake. We don't know that focus exactly, as well as two foci uptake in the left axilla. This most, in the left axilla, you can see this uptake is adenopathy, most likely. So in intramammary and axillary lymph node metastasis from infiltrating lobular carcinoma.
Okay.
Next. Quickly.
This is craniocaudal view of the left breast. Screening mammogram showing area of asymmetry at the center anterior behind the nipple with associated focal area of architectural distortion, no skin thickening, nipple retraction, or abnormal mass seen. So I have to
look again. Look again. look at outer breast.
There is yes. There is a large low density region lesion at the lateral part of the middle breast with
at what?
Lateral part of the breast, middle part. Lucent lesion or mixed density with the lucent area.
Yes.
Mixed density with the lucent area.
Yes.
Surrounded by vessels. Most likely representing.
Where is the vessel?
That in circular.
I cannot see the vessels, but I can see a lobulated equal density oval lesions with area, low density areas. Okay, so yes. It can be
a mass like a hamartomatous mass or with no calcification. It could be or lymph node.
Intramammary lymph node. Okay, so this is a spot.
Mm-hmm. Spot magnification view showing the mass is a large oval shape also.
Why you are saying large? Is it large? Is it very large this, mass?
It could be more than 1 centimeter.
Yeah, maybe one or one and a half. This magnification view, yes, one or one and a half centimeter, maximum 2 centimeter length.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yes.
And less than 1 centimeter width. Okay.
Yes, the mass.
So the spot magnification confirmed this I equal density mass is with central lucency and circumscribed oval.
Oval shape mass.
Subtle lobulation or macro lobulations. So
and,
most probably.
Spot of calcification. Most probably, I think there is a spot of calcification.
Here I can suspect this might be vessels coming near. Okay.
Okay. So this feature representing. Representing intramammary lymph node.
Mostly intramammary lymph node. This is well circumscribed or well-defined mass with central fatty hilum in the upper quadrant going with intramammary confirmed on ultrasound.
Ultrasound
is more typical here.
Yes, confirmed. It oval shape mass with high density hilum and low echogenicity of the cortex.
Confirming hypoechogenic cortex and
low cortex. Representing intramammary lymph node.
What about the hilum? You said the hilum what?
High echogenic.
Yes, abundant fatty hilum. With echogenicity equal to fibroglandular, which is very typical. It's okay.
Yes.
Continue for this case.
This mediolateral oblique view of the right breast showing well-defined equal density mass at the posterior part of the breast near the pectoralis major muscle. No associated abnormality in the skin or in architecture distortion or asymmetry at the axilla.
Again. Describe it again.
This is mediolateral oblique view of the right breast showing a well-defined circumscribed equal density mass at the posterior.
It's the same well-defined as circumscribed, but we said now using the new descriptor is circumscribed.
Yes, the circumscribed equal density mass as the posterior part of the breast near the pectoralis major muscle.
Excellent.
No associated architecture distortion or skin changes or asymmetry. But in the axilla, there are multiple circumscribed masses at the axilla with a high density, and some of them show lucent areas. So it is it could be intra-axillary lymph node. So I need to appreciate it on ultrasound.
Okay, you describe the upper as yani, these are lymph nodes. This is the intra-axillary are lymph node, but the nodule lower down. What is your impression about these lesions?
And I give it by that three.
The nodule projecting over the pectoralis, and importantly, you can see the pectoralis through it, and you describe it well. It is iso, or it is equal, or relatively low, and you can see the pectoralis through it. There is no adjacent distortion. Pectoralis muscles, it's not tethered, and there is no surrounding any reactions. Okay, and it is circumscribed. So
I give it.
And above which I could see a lymph node in the axilla.
Axilla. It could be reactive lymph node, or it could be pathological or lymph node. So, and so you have to do ultrasound for more characterization of this lesion and the lymph node.
Okay, and you suspect it to be. When you go to ultrasound, suspect it to be.
I give it by RAT3, this lesion.
Yeah, you suspect it as what? BRAT3, but you suspect it as cyst. You suspect it at what?
It could be, yes, it could be a cyst.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, because high density
circumscribed. Differential by location. By location, it could be.
By location.
Does it look similar to this?
It could be a lymph node, yes.
Can you see?
It could be an intramammary lymph node.
Intramammary lymph node, but who is talking? Abir?
Yes.
Yeah, by locations, this, yes. Intramammary lymph node number one.
Also
okay.
The lymph node.
So alaikum. Small. Alaikum
salam. Yes, Medina.
Ah, Medina. You're welcome. We
Hi,
miss you.
How are you? Thank you.
Where are you?
Thanks you. I was stuck. والله مشاكل كثيرة لكن في الآخر تخلصت منها جميعا وحصلتها.
You're welcome. لكن
I could not a halo of fatty around the this lymph node, which it is well defined, well separable from the muscle. So most probably it is a lymph node like the axillary ones.
Excellent, well done. A small lesion overlying the pectoralis muscle and low density, well defined. You can actually see the pectoralis muscle profile through the lymph node. More nodes higher in the axilla. This is typical node. It has all the hallmarks of a node, and further workup is not indicated. That is only, this is an intramammary lymph node, okay?
Yes,
mean of criteria.
Yes, I can appreciate this lucency around the focal lesion in the at the pectoralis muscle. It could be eccentric fatty hilum, so it is an atypical lymph node.
But because it is itself, it is low. You see, the lesion is low, and it is by locations and the same lymph nodes in the axilla, and all the criteria constellation of all findings, you will go for just intramammary lymph nodes. Okay, you can put your probe just to reassure yourself that this is a typical type of lymph node. So let us go for the management of intramammary lymph node metastasis. What do you suspect if the intramammary lymph node is metastatic? Okay, they said metastatic involvement of intramammary lymph node is the rare first sign of breast cancer. It's not common. Okay? And maybe evident that suggests the location of primary lesion, if the lesion, even if the lesion is large. This is particularly true when breast tissue is mammographically dense or there is a complex parenchymal pattern. Like the first patients you see with subtle architectural distortion on the lateral aspect. When you have seen the lesion, the intramammary lymph node in the same area, you suspect that in the same quadrant, the primary breast cancer, you have to go on the mammography or in the breast imaging and search for the primary cancer in the same region or same quadrants. So it will give us a clue to search for the primary cancer if it is not obvious and not showing itself on imaging, like in dense mammography or mammography with complex type of parenchymal pattern. Okay, and as you know, on MLO, the both intramammary lymph node as well as the axillary lymph node will be well appreciated. Okay, because both intramammary lymph node located high in the axillary tail or tail of expanse and the inferior axillary lymph nodes overlying in the same region, sometimes it's difficult to differentiate between the two, the low-lying axillary lymph node or high intramammary lymph node. However, as we described before, you should depend on the surrounding breast parenchyma. If the lymph node is surrounded by breast parenchyma, that it is intramammary lymph node. If not, it will be in the axilla. And as we mentioned before, the intramammary lymph node usually should not be more than, if it is more than 1 centimeter, we'll say this is pathological or atypical lymph node. While axillary lymph node, yani, if it is more than 1.5 centimeter, then you might say this is abnormal lymph node. However, up to 3-4 centimeter intra and axillary lymph node, and it still can be benign or normal lymph node, residual of previous reactive or previous inflammation, adenopathy, it persists as large lymph node approaching 4 or even 5 centimeter, but you will find abundant fatty hilum. It will be replaced by fat in this case. You got my point? Okay. There is lack of good quality on the management of metastatic intramammary lymph node. Still, there is debate. There is a lot of debate regarding the staging and the management of intramammary lymph node. However, many papers have shown that metastasis to intramammary lymph node is an independent factor of poor prognosis of breast cancer, regardless of axillary lymph node. According to 8th edition of American Joint Committee on Cancer Staging, intramammary lymph nodes are designed as axillary, not for staging purposes. They consider it as axillary lymph node. Presence of intramammary lymph node metastasis change the pathologic and the clinical staging even in absence of positive considered. They consider it as metastatic lymph node regardless the axillary lymph node being involved or not. On the other hand, there is a prognostic advantage in the presence of an isolated metastatic intramammary lymph node when compared with solitary metastatic lymph node. Based on these findings, some authors, there is questions about how to treat the patient who have positive intramammary lymph node and negative axillary lymph node. Whether it would be more appropriate to manage the involved in intramammary lymph node as separate focus of cancer within the breast parenchyma or as metastatic lymph node. Here is the debate, as suggested by the American Joint Committee on Cancers. Okay? Because intramammary lymph node metastasis alone does not represent multicentric disease. What does it mean? If the patient having breast cancer in the medial breast or lower breast and in the upper outer breast, there is intramammary lymph nodes, metastatic intramammary lymph nodes, we cannot consider it as a multicentric disease. We consider it as metastatic adenopathy. Okay, we consider it as metastatic adenopathy, not a multicentric. So in this case, if the patient apply for conservative therapy, they can do it as they described or as they mentioned. However, an auxiliary sentinel lymph node biopsy always performed to actually assess the disease status of the axilla. What does it mean? If the patient having a metastatic intramammary lymph node, but by imaging the axilla that doesn't show suspicious adenopathy, they will go for sentinel lymph node biopsy to make sure if the axilla is involved or not. And there are two situations, okay? They mentioned that intramammary lymph node metastasis in the presence of negative axillary sentinel node biopsy should not imply radiation or surgical treatment of the axillary lymph node. If the intramammary lymph node is involved, okay, but the sentinel lymph node biopsy, okay, in the auxiliary lymph node is negative, in this case, there is no treatment of the auxiliary lymph node, neither surgically or by radiations. But if the intramammary lymph node detected as the sentinel node, which can occur in 0.2 to 14% of breast cancer patients, in this case, okay, the decision will perform axillary dissections. If the intramammary lymph node is seen in sentinel node biopsy, okay, then they are going to apply. That means the axilla is being involved and it has to be treated. But if it is negative, axilla is and positive in primary lymph node with metastasis is not going to be involved. Did you get this point? Okay. In the presence of histologically confirmed metastatic intramammary lymph node without other non-suspected lesions in mammography, then we have to go for MRI. Like ipsilateral metastatic axillary lymph node with occult cancer on conventional imaging. We are going to treat the patient with intramammary metastatic intramammary lymph node with occult conventional imaging the same as ipsilateral metastatic lymph node with negative or occult mammosonogram. Then we will go for breast MRI searching for primary breast cancer for that metastatic intramammary lymph node. Rarely, abnormal intramammary lymph node can represent metastasis from occult breast carcinoma. This is occur rarely, or may result from lymphoproliferative disease or metastasis from extramammary cancer, as we described before, like melanoma, ovarian cancer, lung or thyroid, or even GI. Okay. So unilateral enlargement of axillary or intramammary lymph node on otherwise negative mammogram is rare, but it occurs. And as you know, then you might find an occult breast cancer. Differentiation of benign from malignant causes may be impossible on basis of imaging findings. And if you have seen on imaging and you may raise suspicious, it might still be a benign cause like reactive hyperplasia. So we have to proceed for, if it is suspicious or atypical, we have to proceed for pathological diagnosis and to make sure if it is metastatic and there is no lesion, then you might proceed for MRI, or if it is just a benign, reactive or other causes of benignity like connective tissue disorders, or if it is due to silicon adenopathy or HIV adenopathy, or even viral infections, tuberculosis adenopathy, other benign causes, it's okay. Bilateral axillary adenopathy favors the diagnosis of lymphoproliferative. If you will find bilateral adenopathy, we'll see it commonly in connective tissue disorders, in lymphoma, and whereas ill-defined speculated adenopathy is favor of metastatic breast carcinoma. Okay, in patients in whom there is no clinically evident primary tumor, breast carcinoma is most likely the primary tumor for the axillary lymph node metastasis. If there is no, the patient has no primary tumor at all and coming with enlarged axillary lymph nodes, suspicious on imaging, taking a biopsy, and found to be metastatic from adenocarcinoma of unknown primary. So the most likely primary site, it will be the breast. Okay? As you know, the mammographic sensitivity, it can be as low as 30% or 29%. So it can, the cancer can be occult. Even when breast tissue is obtained, including by means of mastectomy, the primary breast lesion will not be confirmed in about 1/3 of the cases. For those groups, you are searching for the primary site of tumor, even after mastectomy, you might not find the primary cancer in up to 30% of the patient or 35% of the patient. To 1/3 of the patient, you might not reach the site of primary cancer. If metastatic disease is found in intramammary lymph node, staging and management proceed as if the patient had axillary lymph node involvement stage 2, or even such involvement is demonstrated. Okay? Okay, let us see this mammography. Medina, you're welcome. Tell us what is going on in this mammogram.
Okay, this is CC and cut image of MLO of the left breast. shows there is a retroareolar inner elongated mass. Connected to the nipple with a nipple retraction.
Okay, can you see the nipple?
No.
So why you said nipple retraction, Medina?
Because I didn't see the nipple itself.
So if you did not see it, okay, don't mention it. Okay, again, can you describe it again? Okay, in the lower inner left breast, there is what, is it a mass or something? What, how you can describe it? Looks like,
It looks like obesity.
What is the shape of this obesity? If you look for the MLO.
Tubular. Yes.
Tubular, yes, you have a tubular obesity.
Yes.
They're radiating from the nipple. So, it should be expected to be. Mm-hmm.
Ductal origin or inverted nipple itself?
Duct, yeah, duct. Can you see more than this obesity? Can you see more ducts?
Yes, in the but this is seen all only in the CC view in the outer side. Also,
there is another tubular. Can you see another tubular opacities?
Yes, another tubular opacity in the outer quadrant or in the outer breast.
Is it the same? Is it tubular or this is part of the parenchyma? Part of the dense parenchyma.
Yes, it could be in the outer breast, could be part of
could
the
parenchyma. Could be, or you can see. There is difference between it could be, or you can see another duct. So if it is one duct, we call it, how we can describe it? We said this is, if it is a single dilated duct.
Yes.
So?
It may be, it could be ducted casia.
Okay, so we call it as, do you know that the this lecture talking about what?
No.
Okay. Okay. Okay, let Sarah Almak, let Sarah continue.
Okay.
Because you enter from the middle. Sarah Almak. Mm-hmm. Where are you? Are you available? Sarah is not there. Hint.
Yes, we are talking about special lesions in the breast. These are lesions with special characteristics or unique characteristics, which include intramammary lymph nodes we have just talked about, and the other is solitary dilated duct. So in this mammogram, as just Nadina has mentioned, there is a tubular density in the lower in the breast towards the going towards the nipple. So the next it looks like a solitary dilated duct. We need the complementary ultrasound.
Okay, you need complementary ultrasound. It's a complementary ultrasound.
So it shows, a solitary dilated duct. And the arrow showed that part of the duct is opacified.
Excellent.
Echogenic, the end of the duct is echogenic and
so what is next? How you confirm what is that? How you could confirm
the
what is inside the duct?
The color doppler.
Excellent, color doppler. Mm-hmm. That is the color doppler.
Vascularity within the echogenic part.
Excellent. Okay. So we are talking about?
This could be a papilloma.
We are talking first, we are talking about
intraductal soft tissue mass.
Intraductal soft tissue mass or intraductal as lesions, intraductal yes. enhancing intraductal soft tissue lesions. Okay? So then we'll go for the differential. Yes, you are right. Papilloma is the commonest among other differential diagnosis. So we have to go for tissue diagnosis.
Yes.
Okay. This solitary dilated duct identified at screening mammography in a 64-year-old woman. Ultrasound guided core biopsy revealed low-grade ductal carcinoma inside. Okay.
Mm. Yes.
7 millimeter in greater dimension, although ultrasound examined illustrates sonographic findings, solitary dilated duct, mediolateral oblique shows dilated retroareolar duct, transverse ultrasound shows dilated duct corresponding to mammography with equigenic filling defect representing intraductal mass. Biopsy revealed ductal carcinoma inside. Mm-hmm. So, we are talking about solitary dilated ducts.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Okay. So, how you are going to grade solitary dilated duct? We forget to mention the intramammary lymph node. How you code the intramammary lymph node as BI-RADS?
If it is with typical benign lesions, BI-RADS 2.
Yes, when it is typical, it's BI-RADS 2. When it is atypical, it can be BI-RADS 3, it can be BI-RADS 4, so on. Okay, what about the solitary dilated duct? Wait, hint, don't answer. Give the chance for, so yes. Is your case, but let me ask others. What about the solitary, since it is special, it is unique. So intramammary lymph node, just typical intramammary, it is BI-RADS 2. So what about the solitary dilated duct? This is just a, not very important. Solitary dilated duct, it is BI-RADS, supposed to be BI-RADS
2.
Supposed to be BI-RADS 2. Who said BI-RADS 2?
Medina.
Medina BI-RADS 2. Okay.
Yes, if it before, is just a dilated duct not associated with soft tissue mass or so.
Yeah, now you start to talk in a good way.
Mm-hmm.
you're right. You should not take it like this. Just yes. Solitary duct before they are not giving a lot of concern for the solitary dilated duct. Yes, mm-hmm. Solitary dilated duct, it is BI-RADS 2 or even or mostly 3.
Yes.
See? But now no. They change. Mm-hmm. What do you think?
According to the according to the associated lesions with it, like for example, the previous case, it was for
if just you have solitary dilated duct on mammography, how you are going to code it?
Without
you give it BI-RADS?
From mammography, it will be 2 or 3, but then with, after ultrasound, it will give the final BI-RADS.
No, it should not be. It should not be. Just and you put it 2. Yes, before. They have no. They are not giving a lot of concern for the solitary duct, but now they are giving. Yes, solitary dilated duct, as you describe, is unilateral tubular or branching structures, likely representing a dilated duct or otherwise enlarging large ducts. Is rare, poorly understood. However, solitary duct, okay. In recent research, they suggest a change in assessment and management for these rare findings. And from what was recommended previously. Okay. Why? They found the risk of malignancy is approximate 10% for the solitary dilated duct without associated other feature, without associated mass, without associated architectural distortion or microcalcification, the risk approaching 10%. So it is by RAT4, at least by RAT4A. So the likelihood of malignancy is greater than 2. Greater than 2, it will be above by RAT3. Yes. So sufficiently high to suggest that suspicious by RAT4 assessment as appropriate or maybe appropriate. See, even if unassociated with other suspicious clinical or mammographic findings, it has been reported of solitary dilated duct, the only mammographic findings of underlying malignancy, and they found to be associated with non-calcified DCIS, indicating its potential importance in early detection of breast cancer. However, some investigators, they estimated that the findings of solitary duct has very low risk of malignancy, supporting its assessment as benign by RAT2 or probably benign by RAT3 lesions. Therefore, you see, although previous edition of BI-RADS Atlas indicated that this lesion is usually of minor significance, clinical significance, one should now, at current edition, consider additional imaging evaluations leading to tissue diagnosis unless a benign etiology is demonstrated. You have to search. You have to make sure, is it benign or malignant? You have to give it concern, not like before, not just mention it by RAT 2 or by RAT 4 from the beginning, and that is it. We have to go further and to clarify it and to look at it and to make sure if it is just simple things like simple ductectasia, that means by RAT 2, or complicated ductectasia, duct with internal echo para 3 to para 4, if there is intraductal lesions or remarkable mural thickening and calcifications or associated mammographic suspicious features or other imaging features. So dilated breast duct is widening and shortening of the milk ducts. And so we describe all these. And as we mentioned, that can be associated with inflammations, periductal mastitis, common in the perimenopausal and menopausal age group, and so forth. We have to go for all imaging, and the patient can be receive antibiotic and getting better. Okay. And just we have to clarify and to make sure that it might not need to have unnecessarily biopsy. This is here an example, okay, of solitary dilated ducts, and this ultrasound the solitary dilated ducts demonstrate intraductal soft tissue lesions, and this is the elastography showing a high density lesions, and on pathology it was a papilloma. Another lesions, you see, simulating fibroadenoma on ultrasound in a solitary dilated complex here, but intraductal soft tissue mass having also on elastography demonstrate high density, and it tends also to be a papilloma. And this is, what about this one? What is your impression here? Medina? So this is a solitary dilated ducts.
Yes, solitary short dilated ducts. Ultrasound, it looks of clear fluid, no soft tissue mass.
Excellent.
Duct ectasia. Or single or solitary dilated duct.
Yeah, duct ectasia. So yes. The diagnosis will be duct ectasia by RAD2 because it is clear. Mm. It is homogeneous. Homogeneous content, clear, low, or echo-free. So just it is a duct ectasia. So literally, so this it will be para two in this case.
Yes.
Okay. And this one, a solitary dilated duct, okay. Let us finish the solitary dilated duct and go for the third special case.
This is the mucosal and mediolateral oblique view of the left breast showing retroalveolar high density tubular structure, most likely representing dilated duct. On ultrasound, it shows dilated duct with soft tissue lesion and thick wall, thick anterior wall.
Okay, what about the mammogram? You forget something. There is
on mammography, you have an error. Yes. On mammography also, there is a subtle architectural distortion at the pointed by the orange arrow.
Yes.
And associated axillary lymph node enlargement, some of them showing Brazier fatty hilum.
Okay, so at least you have an architectural distortion
from
concerning findings. And on ultrasound, corresponding to the focal architectural distortion is?
There is an
it's posterior to the duct. So
yes,
this is the area of architectural distortion seen as?
At mammography representing heterogeneous, ill-defined, irregular margin, mass.
Soft tissue mass, yeah. Soft tissue mass. And the duct is not is heterogeneous, it's not echo-free.
Yes,
it's filling with soft tissue. Filling with soft tissue. And the mass here, it is seen as?
Elastography represents high density mass.
So the findings, it will be?
Suspicious for malignancy.
It will be suspicious.
Yes.
So this is suspicious lesions and it was invasive cancer. This solitary duct is related to the invasive. If you look here, yes, you can see the solitary duct here, but it is the same, you see, same direction of the ductal arborization or ductal system. And if you look here, it's also following, yes, it is far from the duct, but it is along the same direction of the ductal system. But yes, sometimes cancers, you see, extending through the ducts, okay, going and settle behind the nipples, the ducts behind the nipples, and infiltrating the ducts or giving the ductal extension. Or if you can see here, this is a duct, and this is a ductal extension of the tumors. What is BI-RADS here? How you are going to code this?
Why? In addition, there is skin sickening and nipple retraction in addition to the area of asymmetry. Yes, this is the area of the dilated duct, but also there is...
This is a duct?
Yes.
Are you sure?
No.
Not for the direction.
Yes.
It is...
Retroareolar mass,
but... So
look at this mass or these lesions. How does it look?
The direction.
It's sharply demarcated. Not only that, sharply, the whole, there is lucency surrounding and there is some lucency seen along the mass, and it is abutting the areolar skin. If you look carefully, there are some faint lucency, illucent line along the lesion itself. We call it what, do you know? You'll see it in other lesions more clearly. So at least it will be Bharat. If it is not 2, it will be Bharat 3. But this is Bharat 2. Why it is Bharat 2?
Could it be skin lesion?
Why the chest x-ray you will see a lucent around the nipple? Three quarter of the nipple it will be lucent, while one area is not. Why? Just x-ray. Okay. Let me see this case, okay? Mm-hmm.
Okay.
What's your impression in this case? I think you have seen it before.
Skin lesions.
Why skin lesions?
Multiple nipples.
Yes, and?
Hello, around it.
Yes, here it attaches the skin from here, while the... The area surrounding by air, demarcated, surrounded by air. You see? This is in a case of neurofibromatosis. You have seen it before. Okay, let me see this case. Yalla Shabab, what's your impression here? What is abnormality?
These are craniocaudal views of post stress. Showing that there is a lesion in the inner part of the right breast. This lesion is well.
Where? Demarcated. Inner,
That's okay.
At what o'clock?
Yes.
Extreme medial posterior. Extreme posterior medial, okay.
At 3 o'clock.
Extreme medial, okay, posterior. Okay.
The lesion is well demarcated. It's equal density to the breast parenchyma. And surrounded by lucent line. Indicating that it could be a skin lesion.
Yeah, what are supporting to be skin lesions?
Lucent line all over around just one area or less than
quarter. Yeah, the posterior portion is not clear. But at least what you have seen from the border are sharply demarcated and subtle adjacent skin thickening is there. It's okay. So next I will go for. It was not seen on MLO. It was not seen on MLO.
I will do tangential views.
Okay. Not done.
You have to do a cleavage valley.
Ultrasound.
Okay.
Cleavage.
This is ultrasound. Look for the extreme median location. Excellent. You describe a 3 block, but extreme median.
Okay. The ultrasound show well defined, a little bit heterogeneous mass, oval shape. Well circumscribed with posterior acoustic enhancement. The mass is heterogeneous, but most of it is hypoechoic. It's of a most probably spine. Spine mass. And
what's your diagnosis?
It's a skin lesion, so my differential will be
if the skin or it is a skin. Is it a skin lesion or
it is not in the breast parenchyma? So my differential will be a skin or skin tax lesion.
Your differential is what?
Like will be of a differential of a skin lesion or.
But you said
other
just now you said
the,
is it skin or breast lesions? Breast parenchyma lesion or skin lesion, huh?
It is a skin lesion as it's compressing the breast parenchyma posterior to it.
Okay, you mean it is an skin lesion. Okay. So why it is a skin lesion?
The breast capsule or the capsule of the parenchyma could be appreciated posterior to this lesion.
Okay, one issue. But still, it can be. It is in the within the anterior part, subcutaneous part. Still, it can be related to the breast tissue.
Not surrounding glandular tissue.
Okay, nose around glandular tissue. Maybe, but still it can. How come it can? What about the part of the skin? Do you remember the anatomy?
Dermal, subdermal.
What are the layers or the composition or the structures of the skin?
It is the dermis, the most outer layer of the skin.
Okay.
Then the epidermis and then the subcutaneous layer.
Subcutaneous layer, yes. And the most outer layer you said is?
The dermis.
The dermis? Uh-huh. And epidermis.
Yes, it is in the epidermis. This lesion is in the epidermis. That means it could be...
The inner layer is epidermis or the inner layer is dermis? Which one?
Layer is epidermis. Epidermis is the inner layer.
Epi, يعني شنو لما تقولي epi?
Outer. Epi means outer, like epicardium.
Okay. Epi on top, يعني. Okay. Yeah. Okay. So the epidermis, it will be
the outer layer.
Outer layer, and then the inner layer is
the dermis,
and the subcutaneous is, we call it hypodermis. Okay. So where is that lesion? The lesion, this lesion is where exactly located?
In the dermis.
Huh?
In the dermis.
The epicenter of which, where?
Excuse me, I didn't hear you.
The bulk of this lesion, the bulk of this lesion is located where?
In the hypodermis, the subcutaneous.
Excellent, in the hypodermis. The bulk of the lesion in the hypodermis with extension into?
The dermis.
The dermis. Okay. With extension into the dermis. Then, in this case, we would like to know, is the lesion is originally, okay, dermal lesions extending into the hypodermis, or the lesion is a hypodermal originating from the hypodermal, and the differential diagnosis is different. If the lesion is originating in the hypodermis, including even the breast type lesions, okay, breast related lesions, the terminal duct lobular unit, okay, the lesion arising from terminal duct lobular unit can be seen in the subcutaneous part or the hypodermal part. So we would like to know if the lesion, when we have seen a lesion within the hypodermis or subcutaneous part of the breast, would like to make sure, is it a dermal in origin or not dermal in origin? To look at the differential diagnosis, rest of the differential. To exclude first the dermal. Why to exclude the dermal? Because are having limited differential diagnosis and almost always,
benign etiology,
including mainly two differential diagnoses, which are
sebaceous gland lesions, like sebaceous cyst,
including sebaceous cyst, and more common. And sebaceous is?
Liboma
within the skin. Liboma, the commonest in the subcutaneous is liboma. In the hypodermal, the commonest is liboma. But when it is a dermal origin, in the hypodermis, but it is dermal origin, we have two cysts.
Dermoid.
One is more common than the other.
Inclusion cyst.
Which inclusion?
The dermis contains the sweat gland and the sebaceous gland. So could be lesions related to the sweat gland.
Uh-huh. So what are the cysts you have seen?
Dermoitis, sorry, dermoitis.
Epiderma.
Okay. Yes, yes, yes.
Huh? Epidermal inclusion cyst.
The epidermal, the commonest is epidermal inclusion cyst. Okay? This is the commonest. Epidermal inclusion cyst. And less common is sebaceous cyst. And by imaging, could you give me the difference between the two on imaging? The difference between sebaceous and epidermal inclusion cyst, imaging wise? Shabab, in a hurry, let us finish this part of the lecture. What are the differences, Yahint? What are the differences between imaging wise, between the epidermal inclusion cyst and the sebaceous cyst?
Actually, I don't remember.
Actually, there is no imaging difference between sebaceous cyst and epidermal inclusion cyst. The difference is pathological. You could not differentiate by imaging between the two. And we mentioned epidermal inclusion cyst because it's far more common than sebaceous cyst. Except that one is arising from the tip, one from the base of the hair follicles. Which one arising from which and which is from which? We'll go through that for a while. But what do you suspect for these lesions? Is it hypodermal or dermal lesions? Let us, then we'll go for the difference. Okay. Mm-hmm. What do you suspect? Suspect dermal or hypodermal origin?
Hypodermal origin.
I'll tell you this is a dermal. This is epidermal inclusion cyst, okay? This is epidermal inclusion cyst. And if you are for the mammography, if you are in a doubt, you can do tangential view, as you said. And this is another patient. The lesion was seen within the parenchyma, and they had done tangential view, confirmed that the lesions sharply demarcated related to the skin, okay? Dermal in origins. So the epidermal inclusion cyst and sebaceous cyst, both by imaging, we could not differentiate between the two. Both of them appear as circumscribed, okay, with smooth border mass abutting the skin surface, projecting into subcutaneous tissue rather than out from the skin surface. Tangential view, as you mentioned here, we mentioned they can do tangential view to visualize it. Okay. So distinguishing pressed skin lesion from superficial pressed parenchymal lesion is essential. We need to know how to differentiate between the two. And there are diagnostic criteria and imaging characteristic as well as a bit false regarding that issue. Okay.
In the ultrasound, the epidermal regions usually has a flow of skin around them.
Why did not describe in the previous study, in the previous case, previous lesions? Okay, we'll go through that. That is why I was asking why that lesions, it is dermal.
Okay.
Yes.
It was a dermal lesion. It was epidermal inclusion cyst.
Yes.
Okay. Let me see this mammography.
Mm.
You have mammogram and you have a spot magnification view, and this is a skin lesion. Where there is a hint?
I need other
volunteer to tell me why this is multiple skin lesions. Why are these are skin lesions? Mm-hmm. I would like to go quickly, Shabab. Okay, a hint. Why this is skin lesion?
Radiolucence is around them, surrounded by air.
And even if you see the lucency is not only surrounding, even here, there are lucency, as if the lucency is surrounding front in a case of, we call it what? This type of lesions, skin warts or verqui. Okay, these are skin lesion, have air surrounding them and are compared with appearance of nipple on chest x-ray as we mentioned. And the lesions might be complicated by ointment if the lady put ointment or put creams in her skins. And the other tips is just look for the sheet. If the technicians or technologists should try it, that the patient have skin lesion at that location, or she might put a marker at the skin lesion to be visualized on mammography. So normal anatomy of the skin is essential to understand the normal anatomy of the skin to know the skin or dermal lesions. As you mentioned, you have hypodermis, dermis, and epidermis, okay? And you know the hair follicles extending from the dermis into the epidermis. So at the base here, and the infundibulum high at the tips, okay? And you have to know each level or each layer contain which structures. So this will help you in the differential diagnosis. The epidermis composed of several layers and contain no blood vessels or lymphatics. There is no blood vessels or lymphatics. Reside the hair follicles, sebaceous glands, sweat glands, nerve endings, and these. That is why the sebaceous cyst is related to the dermis, and the hypodermis typically contain all these structures, you see, except for the hair follicles. And you have to know, we describe in the anatomy, you see, all these details and the thickness of the skin and the appearance on imaging. As you have seen here, the only ultrasound can demonstrate the dermis and epidermal layer with hypodensity in between, as well as hypodermis. While on mammography, both dermis and epidermis and dermis seen as thin, a hyperdense layer, you see, thickened around the areola, it is 0.2 millimeter maximum, but can be more than that around the areola. And same for the MRI, seen as a single enhancing layer, you see, 2 millimeter or less, also thickened around the nipple. Okay, mammography is optimal to localize skin or dermal calcifications, while ultrasound is good to delineate the dermal lesions. And we have criteria for evaluations of dermal from hypodermal lesions based on ultrasound. And so also ultrasound is high resolutions. Okay, criteria make it superior to mammography and even MRI in evaluating these type of the lesions. Let us see the differential diagnosis for the dermal and hypodermal. The dermal are just the sebaceous and epidermal inclusion cysts as well as dermal calcifications, while hypodermal having a wide differential diagnosis, including fat originating lesions like lipoma, angiolipoma, fat necrosis, all these characteristically seen on ultrasound as variable degree of hyperechogenicity. Then the vascular lesion, hemangioma, thrombotic vessels, neurogenic tumors like schwannomas, and these lymphatic or lymph node, anterior terminal ductlobular unit lesions like papilloma, fibroadenoma, sclerosing adenosis, or even cancer, invasive cancer, and breast cancer, it's been mentioned here, it's okay. Common dermal lesions, we describe the dermal lesions as either epidermal inclusion cyst or sebaceous cyst. The epidermal inclusion cyst is arising from the infundibulum. You see, from the uppermost portion of the hair follicles, which the part is seen within the epidermis. You see, this part is within the epidermis. From its name is epidermal inclusion cyst. So epidermis being included within the dermis, or sometimes even within ectopically within the parenchyma, pres parenchyma, and this usually occurs as a result of injury or trauma. You see, these trauma can be including the biopsy as well as mammoplasty and other types of intervention or even accidental trauma, okay? And can be associated with squamous metaplasia and rarely squamous cell carcinoma. And can get inflamed, and on mammography can give us circumscribed but dense, low dense lesions, see, because it's contain keratinizing oily materials. And when it gets inflamed, you see it's surrounding by extensive vascularity and tissue edema. And in this case of inflammation, the patient should be followed clinically and radiologically until complete resolutions. These are multiple examples of appearance, ultrasound appearance of epidermal inclusion cyst. You see, it can be cystic, purely cystic, can be heterogeneously hypoechoic, here purely cystic, here heterogeneously hypoechoic, and sometimes might give internal vascularity, although it is cyst, and it can give us a whorled layers, you see. This is due to lamellated keratinaceous materials, you see, giving this swirling. And at mammography, circumscribed IZU or high density material. On tangential view, they are contiguous with the dermis, and calcifications can also be have been reported. Most dermal lesions are palpable with palpability being the reason for imaging evaluation, although occasionally they are first detected as routine screening mammography. A helpful clinical features of valvovolous consist in the presence of tiny visible opening on the skin. If you are seeing a tiny visible opening in the skin, and if you put your probe, you might see a tract. This is characteristic for this type of skin cyst, and sometimes you might even see a whitish discharge, which can, by squeezing this, you can decompress the palpable mass. This is very characteristic for this type of dermal or skin cyst. So the other differential diagnosis of the dermal cyst is the sebaceous cyst. However, it is not as common as the epidermal inclusion cyst. It is less common and are not readily distinguished from epidermal inclusion cyst based on imaging or clinical. Only pathological, and as we described, is arise from the root sheath of the hair follicle, while the epidermal inclusion cyst arising from the tip or the infundibulum of the hair follicle. The sebaceous cyst is also called as steatocytoma. You see steatocytoma, when it is single, we call it simplex. When it is multiple, we call it steatocytoma multiplex. And these are autosomal dominant disorders. Okay, it's a contain oil fluid or creatinaceous material, is circumscribed low density masses, typically appear fatty or occasionally demonstrated variable soft tissue density. At ultrasound, so also range from cystic to soft tissue solid appearance depending on the internal content. You see, they arise in the dermis, or they can expand into subcutaneous fat or hypodermal layer, same as the dermal inclusion cyst. If you have seen here, this is giving even fat fluid levels, steatocytoma, and this presence of the marker indicate that it is a palpable abnormality. And here it's seen as multiple, you see, hypochoic dermal lesion in steatocytoma multiplex. Okay. And this is a dermal calcifications. You see, you know, if it is rounded, smooth, loosened centers, and if you could see it near to the skin or in a tangential view, you might see projecting over the skin. What are the common differential diagnoses or common lesion in hypodermis? These here are examples, you see, of angiolipoma, okay, in this case, and these thrombosed veins, thrombophlebitis, or Mondor disease, see? And this here is a lymph node. Okay, these are multiple lesions. If we look here, these are not typically giving a little bit an obtuse angle with the epiderm, with the dermal layer, signifying that the lesions most likely arising from the hypodermis rather than from the dermis. It doesn't show the close signs, you see, and the angle is more or less. So this is expected to be arises from the breast. And being hypochoic, not hyper, that means are not giving impression that fat containing lesions like lipoma or angiolipoma, these things. And most likely we have to think about the differential diagnosis in this area of lesions arising from terminal duct lobular unit. And you will ask me, why terminal duct lobular unit and the parenchyma is seen far posteriorly? Why terminal duct lobular unit seen within the subcutaneous fat? Can you answer these questions? Do you remember the lectures of anatomy? We described this in the lecture of the anatomy. Any volunteer? Anyone remember that? Any of you remember why? Hint, Abir, Medina?
Some of them could be anterior, but I don't know.
What? The terminal duct lobular unit can migrate through the Huber ligament, you see, and implant it anteriorly, more anteriorly into the hypodermis or the subcutaneous fat. So expected any lesion can arise from the terminal duct lobular unit, you might see it in that area, which include what are the lesions related to terminal duct lobular unit?
Benign lesions like fibroadenoma, like adenosis, and as well as malignant carcinoma.
Excellent. The benign lesions like babyloma, fibroadenoma, adenosis or sclerosing adenosis, and the malignancy like invasive carcinoma or DCIS. So if the lesion is suspicious, and in this case, or this is probably benign, in probably benign, I will suspect babyloma, fibroadenoma versus adenosis. When the lesion is irregular or suspicious, sclerosing adenosis versus carcinoma or DCIS. Because the sclerosing adenosis is a mimicker. Okay, so in this case, they describe A as a babyloma, B as fibroadenoma, C as sclerosing adenosis, and D is ductal carcinoma in situ.
So these are hypodermal
lesions, not dermal lesions. It's okay. So this is another patient with ductal carcinoma in situ. You see, if you look, giving an obtuse angle is infiltrating into the dermal layer. However, giving an obtuse angle, you see. Lesion localizations at breast imaging, the dermal lesion to be localized in imaging. And as we mentioned that mammography is more useful in calcifications, not much useful for identifications or localizations of dermal lesions based on mammography. But they are using certain techniques and using specific alphanumeric grades on this issue and putting in certain areas when it looks medial, putting that on the medial aspect or the reverse, see, to look at the calcifications or dermal lesions exactly if it is parenchymal or related to the skin. And as we have seen, this is clearly here, this is a dermal lesion, lucent centers, and this is the alphanumeric grids used to evaluate for that, determine if the lesion is the skin or not. But as we mentioned, ultrasound is the most useful technique in evaluating the dermal versus non-dermal lesions. You see, and there are certain, because it has a high resolution, and there are certain characteristics used in differentiating edermal from hypodermal lesions. If the lesion is seen completely between the two layers, epidermis and the dermis, and in this example, it will be relaxed that this is clearly an skin lesion seen within the dermis, you see. And what it can help us is using a gel pad or a step off pad of gel. Put large amount of gel, you can see all layers of the skin and you can see the lesions. See, this is here example, ultrasound obtained with blob of a caustic gel. You see, look for any thick layer of caustic gel, shows an epidermal inclusion cyst. This epidermal inclusion cyst located entirely within the skin or within the dermis. Okay. And this here, we can see, what is this sign? If I ask you this lesion, is it a hypodermis or dermal?
In dermal.
Is dermal. Why?
Because the angle is acute. This sign is called the dermal sign.
The close sign. This is a close sign. What is the meaning of the close sign? The same structures, okay, causing an acute angle and wrapping around the lesions. This is the dermis is coming, wrapping around the lesion and causing acute angle with it, indicate that the structures is arising from it. Okay? This occurs in many structures, in many organs, like ovarian cyst. When you saw the glow signs, that means the cyst is intra-ovarian, okay, not para-ovarian. And so forth. You can see it in a spleen. You can see it in many organs to differentiate if the lesions is arising from that structures or from that organs, if the part of the organs, tissue from that organs, wrapping around the lesions, okay, causing an acute angle with that lesions is strongly suggesting its origin. And this case of epidermal inclusion cyst arriving from the dermis. Okay, and there is another sign seen also on ultrasound supporting that this is a dermal cyst, which is?
Sinus tract.
The tract. Mm. This tract indicate what? What does it indicate? Does it differentiate between epidermal inclusion cyst and sebaceous cyst?
No, I think no.
Why?
Because both of them are originating from the hair follicle.
Excellent. Well done, Medina. Excellent. It is seen with both. It is seen with epidermal inclusion cyst as well as sebaceous cyst, because both are arising from the hair follicles. And this tract indicates the hair follicles. When we have seen this, we need to angulate, we need to use the gel pad and angulate the probe and to see this. When we have seen these signs, okay, is very supportive that this is a dermal lesion. If the, in these two cases, the epicenter of the lesion is in hypodermis. However, with the presence of these hair follicles, that mm-hmm. means this the origin is dermal lesions, either sebaceous cyst or epidermal inclusion cyst. This we call it tract-to-skin sign. Tract-to-skin signs and indicate that this is in a case of epidermal inclusion cyst or indicate this is a dermal lesion, though the epicenter of the lesion is down and sometimes you might find difficult to apply the claw signs. However, in the other view here, In other lesions, the close signs is of a dermal tissue. This could be it could be applied. Okay. In general, the high spatial resolution of ultrasound provide more detailed information than mammography or MRI imaging about the relation of the lesion to the dermis. See, to make sure this is a dermal lesions or non-dermal lesions, ultrasound is superior because of high resolutions. And because it contains or it has characteristic features to delineate these or to differentiate between these two different type of lesion. The presence of tract, which represent extension of the hair follicle from the dermis up through the dermis, the epidermis, that extend from the lesion to the epidermal skin surface, confirm the dermal origin as we described and is indicative of the sebaceous or epidermal inclusion cyst because both are originating from it. For lesions that are located either partially or wholly within the hypodermal layer, evaluating the angles that are made between the lesion's margin and the dermis may be helpful. Typically, the lesions that are completely within, let me show you here, okay? We describe that if the lesion is within both, within the two layers, that means dermal and no problem. If it is partially or wholly within, we will look for the angles. Okay, we are going to look for the angles. If the angle is acute, causing a claw, so this is a dermal. If it is an obtuse, okay, that means it is a
hypodermal.
Okay, the ultrasound probe must be angled across multiple planes to visualize. That's in tract, this we have to mention it there, sorry, to be described later. Okay, did you understand this difference in the angles? Is it clear?
Yes.
We said the lesion arises from the dermis, as is seen here. You see, this is a claw. The dermal tissue is coming and wrapping around the lesions, giving they have a 90 degree or acute angle with the dermal line. A claw of hyperechoic skin invaginating around the margins seen support the dermal origin. When the lesion is completely or arising from hypodermis, it will give an obtuse angle like the lesions arising from the chest wall or from the mediastinum versus lung lesions. If we look here, it's difficult to differentiate these lesions or exactly tell if this lesion is hypodermal or dermal based on MRI. But when we look for the same lesion on ultrasound and see the close signs, we'll make sure that is related to the dermis, the dermal layers, you see? The dermal lesions on MRI or the dermal, which also include the sebaceous and epidermal inclusion cysts, are typically appear as iso-intense on T1 and hyper-intense on, or heterogeneously hyper-intense on T2, and generally giving rim enhancement. Sometimes you might see internal enhancement, but because of small lesions, this is represent a volume averaging. See, difficulty in distinguishing superficial malignancies from skin cysts has been reported on MRI, and localizations of lesions at MRI is less accurate than ultrasound, as we described, because of the high resolution of ultrasound. Okay, how to avoid the pitfalls and the misclassifying dermal lesions from anandermal lesions. Look here for this example. What can you see? You can see some skin thickening and added density or asymmetry with suspicious type of calcification in close approximate or close intimate to that skin. That is why mostly it will be diagnosed or classified as skin lesion, which is not the case. It is a malignant type of lesions, but is not related to the skin. These lesions misclassified as skin calcifications. Okay. So to be dermal location beneath the dermis. Skin markers were placed on alphanumerical, these alphanumerical grids. Okay. And if you look here, here also we have, this is the dermal layer, and here there is a small area of distortion and lesions. This is a hypodermal locations in a 53-year-old woman. And there is a small lesions. This is a small, very small lesions here. You see hypodermis and infiltrating into or extending into the dermal. Was initially considered to be dermal in origins, was followed with surveillance, then the lesions is found to be actually hypodermal located beneath the dermis and forming an obtuse angle with the dotted dermis. This is a dermis, they found to be a hypodermal, also misclassified. This is another lesions here. Looks like also in between might be dermis or hypodermis, seen between the dermis and part of which in the hypodermis, but probably hypodermis extending into the dermis. The lesion also misclassified, and yes, the lesion on ultrasound involved both the dermis and hypodermis. At follow-up 6 months, is not shown here, the lesion persists but was considered to be stable with the dermal origin. They consider it a dermal origin. However, look for the follow-up. Here now, you can say dermis or epidermis. Hypodermis, I mean.
Hypodermis.
Now it looks suspicious. It looks a hypodermis lesion infiltrating into the dermis. It looks like a suspicious one. Yes. Ultrasound 1 year from the initial showed the lesions increase in size and visible speculations, become suspicious, extending into hypodermis, excision demonstrate poorly invasive ductal carcinoma. It becomes suspicious. So it can occur. We have to be cautious, and with rare exceptions, okay, dermal lesions encountered by breast imager as a benign. Okay, are benign. inflammatory or inflammations might be indistinguishable from malignancy based on imaging. Does patient with superficial lesion that is suspicious for inflammation must be followed clinically and radiologically until the lesion resolve after treatment. Non-resolution of clinical symptoms or of imaging features or imaging finding should warrant biopsy. When the origin or cause of superficial lesion is indeterminate, then we have to evaluate it by ultrasound to assess for appropriate level of suspicion. And if any suspicious features for malignancy encountered, further evaluation with tissue diagnosis should be considered. But we have to, in this case, we have to consider what? For biopsy? We have to consider what, Yahind?
Sorry, just I lost the
last epidermal year. Inclusion cyst. We should not put a needle. We should not put a needle in case of dermal lesions to avoid rupture of epidermal inclusion cyst. Okay?
And inflammation. Yeah.
Yeah, it can cause inflammation and cellulitis and these reactions. We have to do excisional biopsy. We should not do FNA or true cut biopsy. Okay, so in summary, in dromomary lymph node are lymph nodes seen within the breast tissue, surrounded by breast tissue, can be solitary or multiple. In breast imaging, they generally fall into BIRA2 lesions when are typical. When it is atypical, sometimes can be coded as BIRA3 or even BIRA4 lesions. It depends on level of suspicions. Differentiation of benign from malignant causes may be impossible on basis of imaging alone. Okay, solitary dilated duct visualized by mammography is a rare event. The correlation with ultrasound second look may be present. Ductal ectasia with homogeneous or heterogeneous content being papilloma, the main findings in heterogeneous imaging. When we do ultrasound, either to find homogeneous duct in case of duct ectasia or heterogeneous, like in a case of papilloma or even DCIS or carcinoma. When related to carcinoma, usually comes from associated findings, not being the main findings of mammography. Careful evaluation of imaging features and good knowledge of skin anatomy are important evaluating superficial breast lesions. Ultrasound provides higher spatial resolution than mammography and MRI for dermal lesions, and has characteristic feature like clodermis wrapping around the margin of the lesions and the tract sign leading from the lesions to the skin surface. And in the absence of these features, a superficial breast cancer should be considered. When hypodermal lesions is uncertain, consider histologic analysis of tissue sampling obtained at a needle or excisional biopsy. Why we said excisional? Because supposed to be specially considered in a case of epidermal inclusion cyst to avoid rupture an inflammatory reaction in case of FNA or true cut needle biopsy. What about this lesion, Medina? Can you tell me hypodermis or dermis and why?
This is a well-defined hypoechoic lesion of dermal origin with callosign and skin lesion sinus.
Excellent, well done. Both callosign and sinus tract signs are seen in a dermal lesion. Yes. Mostly it will be
inclusion.
Epidermal inclusion cyst. Excellent, well done, well done, well done. Okay, thank you very much for attention. I hope you enjoy the discussion.